Leen Gorissen, PhD in biology, speaker and writer, is specialized in bio-inspired innovation, nature-based solutions, and with her Center for Natural Intelligence, as opposed to artificial intelligence, yeah, she wants to help every organization to innovate like nature. Nature provides us with 3.8 billion years of trial and error at your service. Please welcome Leen Gorissen. Next, an American director, producer, and cinematographer. And you might know him from his high-end time-lapse cinematography. Yeah? Louie Schwartzberg is a visual artist who focuses on connections between humans and the subtleties of nature. Shot by shot, he delves into the profound connection between wonder, awe, and the natural world, aiming to awaken a sense of wonder and appreciation for all that lives around us. You might know him from Netflix documentaries such as Moving Art, Mysteries of the Unseen World, or Fantastic Fungi. Please give him a warm applause, Louie Schwartzberg. Hey. And for our third guest, food forests are the missing ingredient to heal this planet. I met Louis Diagre while he was moderating a workshop on how to design your own food forest in your own backyard. And the beauty of the concept is that food forest ticks so many boxes that it might feel too good to be true. Imagine a world where everything around you is edible. Isn't that the garden of earthy delights? Please welcome Louis Diagre. Okay, guys. So happy you're here. So happy that we have three different but so beautiful perspectives on natural world and how we can reconnect with it. Maybe Louie, I would like to start with you. Maybe we should first see a movie of what you exactly do, because I cannot introduce a cinematographer without a movie. Guys, can you please show me something?
You're gonna see it.
Maybe pick the one with the mushrooms, because it fits well with the interior. Yes, many people have already, to work with Lou, yes, absolutely. I think a lot of you have already seen the work of Louie without realizing it, but that's a bit his signature, this slow, beautiful movements in nature. Without going into details, can you explain a little bit how it works, how you do this?
Well, I think it's all based on curiosity, and wonder and awe. So I try to make the invisible visible. What we just saw with the hummingbirds was slow motion, shot at 1,000 frames per second. So I'm slowing it down 16 times normal. And I think what it does, it opens your heart because you realize that your point of view is not the only point of view. You know, the way a hummingbird looks at life is different than the way a redwood tree would look at life. And with mushrooms and with flowers, I speed up time, and hummingbirds and bees, I slow down. And I think that when we realize that we are just, you know, one narrow point of view on this planet, then I think we care more about protecting nature, protecting what we love. And if I can get people to fall in love with nature, then automatically I think they'll do everything they can to protect it.
And what you do, yeah. For me, it feels like you portray the unseen, you make visible things that are magical and that we usually are not aware of, but it also seems or feels like it requires a lot of patience to make this work. What exactly drives you? What motivates you in the morning?
Well, I think it's patience, and a lot of it is trust. For example, like with my time-lapse flowers, most of that is shot indoors, and I've been doing that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 40 years nonstop. So the camera is always rolling, and I'm getting 3 seconds to 5 seconds per day, 24 hour period. So I've squeezed 40 years into about 20 hours of film. And as to why, it's like, I think I'm turned on by beauty. The sensual beauty of the flowers and the mushrooms are what make us want life to go forward. I mean, think about the bees and the pollinators. They're turned on by the flower, by the color, by their taste, by their touch, by the aroma. And that relationship is what makes flowers able to reproduce. If they weren't able to reproduce, we wouldn't have fruits, nuts, vegetables, berries. We wouldn't have the light energy from the sun that a plant captures that we need to eat to keep us alive. So beauty is actually a tool of survival, and that is what keeps me going.
However, the beauty, yeah, we know when it comes to the natural world and biodiversity, we hear a lot of bad news. Think about the wildfires, think about unprecedented heat waves, and the biodiversity loss. Can anybody help me showing a picture of how bad it is?
It's really bad. It's heartbreakingly bad. I will go into it a little bit in my presentation. So maybe here I would add the good news is that any living system from nature will do everything it can to maintain itself. So even in its bad state, if we can help nature, nature will heal itself. And I think there is where the most hope and motivation is. So if we now, instead of degrading nature, can change our roles and start regenerating nature, then the process of healing planet Earth can go much more quick than we think it could.
So being aware of its so being aware of its adaptability and creating the context so it can restore and flourish again is important. I think it requires a lot of knowledge, a part of awareness. Are there other models that can provide us with hope, initiatives that can make us hopeful?
There's a lot of things that are going on and we don't know it as humans. A lot of biodiversity, what is biodiversity? We cannot see it, but the thing that's going on is there's gonna be a day where there'll be no more coffee, no more chocolates, no more other foods because of this biodiversity going away. But we are seeing beautiful farming projects that are actually producing food at the same time as producing this biodiversity, where you have those two things coming together. And in my opinion, it's very hopeful to see this, because this way we can show that we, as humans, we are not only destructive, we can also be constructive, work together with nature, have coffee, have chocolate, and also have biodiversity.
Yeah. So you like get away of the classical gap between agriculture and nature. And maybe we see chocolates, we are aware of the chocolate, but we should be aware of the whole system around the chocolate, and maybe we'll appreciate it again.
Exactly, yeah.
It makes me think about one thing I once read, the concept of nature deficit disorder, the phenomenon where people, especially children these days, spend less time outdoors and have reduced connection with nature, which might increase vulnerability in mental health. From your experience, what works? What works in regard of reconnecting people, and maybe especially young people, to connect, reconnect them with nature?
Well, what I'm trying to do is turn young people on. Even at Tomorrowland, we're young, right? We're all young at heart. But I think that, in a way, the digital tools have been very destructive. The iPhone, and young people are addicted to it. But what I'm trying to even offer is, you know, digital nature. I'm actually bringing it into healthcare, into hospitals, when people don't have the opportunity to go to beautiful places, to go to Africa, Galapagos, Machu Picchu, whatever, they can get the sacred energy of nature in a digital display. It doesn't replace it. It's not better than a walk in a forest, but it's one way, I think, to intrigue young people to be turned on to nature. I know that I live in Los Angeles. There's a lot of young kids who live in the inner city, 10 miles to the beach. They've never been to the beach.
Oh my God.
You know, because their values, their culture is all different, you know, and I think that once they see something that's cool and hip, then they'll go, oh wow, that's something I want to explore.
Okay, interesting. At Love Tomorrow, we love thought experiments. Now, let's have a wild kind of thought experiment. Imagine we're going to arrange a spaceship for thousands of people that will have to travel for thousands of years. What would be the design directives to make this travel society flourish? Can you think of some essentials?
No straight lines, all curvy lines, curvy designs. So nothing rectangular.
Yeah. And why is that important?
Because everything in the universe, if you look around, is in flows. Nothing is straight. We are the only species that make everything straight, and it numbs our mind. It makes us unhappy. Yeah. If you see the natural curves of nature, it gives rest. So that would be the first thing I'd do.
So nothing rectangular. No industrial straight lines. Yeah. It should be organic. Something else?
Yeah, fungi. We'd have to have fungi on board, because without the fungi, no soil, no soil, no plants, no plants, no life.
So it's essential we learn about fungi and treat them very well. Yeah. Anything else?
Well, I would say if you are going to survive on a spaceship for thousands of years, your spaceship has to be self-regulating, self-sustaining, self-healing. And guess what? There is a spaceship that we already have. It's called Earth. And it's been traveling out of space for 3.8 billion years, doing exactly that. So that's why it's so important to look to nature as a mentor and a model, and learn from the ways that nature self-regulates herself, that she heals herself.
Yeah.
And in that case, have a kind of directives that we're not allowed to destroy the spaceship.
Yeah, exactly.
It's crazy. We want to go to Mars, you know, and all these rich people with, you know, their spaceships, and when we really need to solve the problems we have on our planet. This is heaven on earth.
We have Lou and Louie, but this question is for Louie with an S. Your talk will be about food forests and the ecological, economical, even geopolitical, but also societal potential. Now imagine an individual, maybe somebody in the room, in the audience, is challenged to transform his own neighborhood, his own city district, into an edible garden. And you're on your own. It's just you as an individual with a dream. What would be the strategic steps?
Well, first of all, I'm challenging all of you to make your surroundings edible. It's very easy. You take a tree, you plant it into the ground, you wait a couple of years, and you'll have apples for the rest of your life. What's stopping you now to do this. You can do this in your own garden, but you can also do it in your street. And the only thing you have to do is you write it down on a beautiful piece of paper with maybe some photos with it, go to some neighbors, show, oh, look, this is the plan. Who is with me? And I'm sure you're going to find at least five people crazy enough to be going with you. Then you go to your city officials and talk to them, and then they might say, okay, you're allowed to plant trees, edible bushes with raspberries, with whatever you like on the street corner. And I know a lot of people who've just done this. And if you get a no from city officials, you can also just do it guerrilla style, do it at night, plant a tree in the park. I also know people who've done this. I've never done this before, of course.
Why don't I believe?
And the thing is, sometimes the city officials think they have planted it, so they come and take care of it. Right. It really happens.
Interesting. Very interesting. Okay, Louie, talking about food forest, that's your story, and one of the beautiful aspects of it is it's so feasible. It just takes a few hours, kids, grandkids, parents, grandparents, whatever, and there you go. And you have a result. Huh? Mm-hmm. I would love to hear your entire story. Maybe, Leen, Louie, we're going to make a little bit space. We're going to set the stage for Louie.